Okay, thank you. As Sasha said, I'll talk about cryptographic sensing, and this is joint work with Eyal, Kushilevitz, Rafail, Ostrovsky, and Amit, Sahai. So this talk can be seen as both about a new question, which is a new interaction with crypto and the physical world, and also as a new interaction of crypto with computational learning theory. So let me introduce first the broad question, that this can be seen as a special case of it. So typically, we have a crypto task X that we want to implement, and we're trying to design a scheme for this task, either trying to minimize assumptions or optimize efficiency in some sense. This work fits along the line of taking a crypto task X and a function class F and trying to fit an implementation of X into the constraints imposed by F. In particular, we're interested in classes F that are somehow realizable by nature. I will explain what this means. So you can think of it as a question of whether we can embed crypto in nature, an instance of this question. And our focus is on the primitive that we want to build, being public key encryption. So there are quite a few relevant line of works, including works on low complexity cryptography, visual cryptography, different forms of physically realizable cryptography, or different interactions of crypto with the physical world, crypto about the physical world. Our notion is quite different, and I'll go straight to describing it via this cryptographic flashlight metaphor. Okay, so let's first consider a standard flashlight. We are in the dark. There is an object X that we want to sense or observe. To this end, we shoot at the object these misspelled photons, Fi. You can think of each Fi as a function that, say, returns a small amount of information about the object. And now our eye can combine these returning signals and observe the object. The main issue here is that from a cryptographic perspective, or one issue from a cryptographic perspective, is that you can have a freeloader standing next to you and they will enjoy the benefit not only of your flashlight, but also use your precious battery power to observe the object, right? So this doesn't seem like a very serious concern, but I'll show other examples where it is. Okay, so our goal is to have a measurement process which is entirely public. So the freeloader can observe both the functions Fi and the answers. The only secret is in these glasses that allow us to observe the object while the freeloader is entirely in the dark. Okay, that's our goal. That's the goal of cryptographic sensing. Okay, so what is the first solution that comes to mind is to rely on just any form of public key encryption, right? So I can shoot this type of functions Fi that will give me a bit-by-bit ciphertext in a public key encryption. I'm basically telling the flower, please send me an encryption of yourself. And if the flower happens to grow, on an old-fashioned computer, then it can actually compute an encryption of itself and send it back to me, which I can decrypt using the secret key. So this works great unless the flower does not grow on a computer. And so the challenge is to make somehow a natural measurement process achieve the same effect. Okay, so just a few words about possible measurement processes. You can, of course, model real light or sound by waves or by particles. This is too complicated for us to understand. So it's not really just about the function, the intended function that we mean to get from these signals, but also about the unintended information that gets back to the adversary that we care about. So this is something to understand. We didn't attempt to understand what is the real information that is being returned by actual light or sound waves. However, we can consider these toy experiments, which you can actually conduct these experiments at home. So one such experiment involves, think of this as some kind of a cardboard figure, or you know, it can have holes in it. All we care about is just the 0-1 pattern of where you have holes and where you don't have holes. And now you can shoot these sprays of water at different intensities, at different parts. Some of it will hit the object, some of it will just continue past it. And now if you have this way to measure the amount of water that you get back, then you can basically learn some integer linear combination of this 0-1 pattern defined by the object. Okay, so this is something that you need to work to make sure that no additional information is revealed, but in principle, this seems physically realizable. You can consider a different version of this where you use noise. You just shoot particles or ping pong balls at the object, you know, and you count the amount of noise, try to time it so that everything hits the object at the same time. Again, an adversary here can see both the pattern of where we shoot, the directions and the velocities that we shoot the ping pong balls, and can hear back the same information that we get. Okay, so these are just ideas for physical realizations of cryptographic sensing. And this is you know, a more mainstream dual interpretation in the language of computational learning theory. So here you swap the role of the function or function class and the object. Here the secret is some concept or function F in a function class capital F, say a CNF formula. And here you just make, you pick a contrived or carefully chosen set of questions or queries to the function that will allow you to figure out what this function F is, being a computationally bounded learning algorithm. Yet, you know, an external observer who can see the entire training sample cannot make sense just because they don't know the line of thought that has led you to pick these particular queries. Okay, so this is a dual interpretation. In the rest of the talk, I will stick to the sensing formulation, if only because the learning formulation, it's more problematic to talk about entropies. It's more sensitive to representation issues. Okay, so this is just to give you some idea of application scenarios beyond the two examples I gave. You can think of conducting polls or trying to analyze you know, chemical structure of some virus or deep learning. And in many of these cases, there are expensive experiments that give us the labeled examples, and these experiments are sometimes done, they cost a lot of money. We use an external lab, for instance. And the goal really is to prevent employee of this lab from selling the results of our experience, of our experiments, and making them useful for our competitors. This is really, in such context, this is the goal, to prevent the intermediary from gaining any benefit from learning the questions and answers that we learn. Okay, great. So how do we define security? Well, luckily, we can just follow the common approaches in cryptography for public key encryption. So the minimal notion would be one-way security, where we assume that the object is completely random, and we require that the adversary cannot guess the object exactly. Of course, a computationally bounded adversary. You can consider something which is perhaps the most realistic option in this context, which is entropic security. So basically, you assume that the object is hidden as long as it has sufficient entropy, and our goal is to make this entropy threshold as low as possible. And I would say a kind of intermediate notion, which follows from it's weaker than entropic security, is this notion of semantic security with background noise, where we basically conduct joint measurements to the object and surrounding noise, and we draw entropy from the noise. So here you can consider different flavors depending on whether the noise is assumed to be uniform or just to have sufficient entropy, and whether the noise is independent of the object or it can be dependent. Okay, but this sounds like a realistic notion in context of measurements of physical objects. And this is the correspondence to classical flavors of public key encryption. Another useful relaxation is to settle for some form of approximate correctness. So instead of getting the exact picture of the object, we may be willing to get some blurry version of the object, slightly blurry version of the object with respect to some metric. And we still insist that the adversary doesn't get any signal. Okay, so we settle for getting a weaker signal, but we still don't want the adversary to get any signal. And there are two goals for this. One goal is a more classical goal of better efficiency, say in the context of compressed sensing, this is what is being used. A small number of linear measurements give you a good approximation of pictures. But in a cryptographic context, perhaps the main advantage is to really get better security by reducing, substantially reducing the entropic requirements. So if we get a weaker signal, there is more conditional entropy in the object. Okay, so still, having said all the disclaimers and relaxations, it still seems pretty crazy. So ignoring the personal insult, I would like to argue that it's not as crazy as it may sound. So for one thing, we know that even if we take traditional public key encryption schemes and we settle for outputting some other representation or encoding of the ciphertext, then we can push them into very low complexity classes like NC0. In our language of sensing, NC0 means that every function fi will compute something like the end of 3 bits in the object XORed with, say, a 4th bit. This is still not very realistic, both because XOR, you know, addition is realistic, XOR is not so realistic in natural context, and also if these bits are far apart from each other, it seems a bit tricky to physically realize this particular type of measurements, but from a complexity theoretic point of view, it's pretty simple. The other point is that another objection that this model raises is that if we consider very simple classes of functions f, these functions are learnable. And if they're learnable, then there is no advantage that the learning algorithm can have over an external observer who can just learn whatever the observer learns. And the point here is that there is some gap or some misconception about learnability of simple complexity classes. So some of the negative results in this area, like the lineal Mansour-Nissan result for AC0, only applies with respect to uniformly chosen inputs, and if you're allowed to choose a contrived distribution of inputs, in fact, it's an open question of how low we can get, say, in complexity classes in AC0 without implying learnability. And finally, in the paper, we also propose a distributed model where you can use, say, two different labs and only insist that each individual lab learns nothing from the experiments it conducts. And in this setting, there is no PKE barrier. Okay, so now, from now, let me focus on the simple class of linear functions. Here we view the object as a vector in 0, 1 to the n. Think of it as black or white, hole, no hole. And a measurement is defined by a linear combination over the integers with coefficients ai. I hope I convinced you that this is physically realizable, at least when the ai's are small. This can correspond to intensity of of the water stream or a size of a ping pong ball. And something that immediately comes to mind is to apply lattice-based crypto. And indeed, you can get some results of this type by using, in a black box way, results from the lattice-based crypto literature. However, these results, as stated, are both complex and also not good in terms of parameters for our purposes. And still, if you know about this stuff, whatever I'm going to say next will be an easy exercise. So please forget what you know and try to follow think slowly. Okay, so let's start as a warm-up by looking at, not as a warm-up, this is the main technical part, but it's still not our final goal. Our final goal is to use linear functions over the integers, and now let's consider the simplest setting of linear functions modulo Q, where here Q, we consider it as a polynomial size modulus in N, the dimension of the object. Okay, so the first reaction, if you talk to a non-cryptographer, you say that this goal is impossible. Why? Because linear functions, even mod Q, are learnable. And you know, if the adversary can observe y equals a times x, this is a result of a bunch of linear measurements, mod Q, the adversary can just solve linear equations and observe the object. The issue is that this is not the case when the system is underdetermined. So when the system is underdetermined, you can have exponentially many solutions in ZQ to the n, yet only a single solution in 0, 1 to the n. This is really a central idea in lattice-based cryptography. And so if we can generate these linear measurements A with a secret trapdoor that allows efficient decoding of this unique X, then we might be in a situation where even if the adversary can try to sample X primes, many X primes, from this space of consistent objects, none of them will be correlated with the real object. So the adversary will be totally in the dark. Okay, that's the hope. Okay, so our solution crucially relies on lossiness, on getting an approximate version of the output, and it's really a simple version of the Regev crypto system for those who know it. So we settle here for good approximate recovery via linear sketching. So instead of learning the entire X, we learn a small number of linear combinations over the integers of the bits of X. And this is enough for good, a good resolution of picture using known sketching techniques. And now the security goal is that we get this entropic security where the entropy bound is roughly the size of the output of the sketch. So the more sketchy the sketch is, the shorter the sketch is, then the better security we get, but the picture becomes more blurry. Okay, it's a trade-off between sharpness of the picture and the level of security. Okay, and using Chinese remaindering, it's enough to recover this sketch modulo 2, modulo 3, modulo 5. So let's see how we can learn the parity of any subset of the bits of X. Okay, so first recall the leftover hash lemma. The leftover hash lemma says that if we multiply X by a K by N matrix A, random K by A matrix A, then the result of A, then A times X looks random, assuming that X has more entropy than the number of rows in A. Okay, this is roughly true. Over ZQ, you have to multiply the entropy by log Q, but it's approximately true when Q is polynomial. So the idea is that if we want to get the inner product of A and X modulo 2, it suffices to learn the inner product of A prime and X modulo Q, where A prime roughly contains, up to some small amount of noise, contains something close to zero whenever AI is zero and close to Q over two whenever AI is one. Okay, so if you get this inner product modulo Q of A prime and X, you can easily recover the inner product mod two of A and X. Okay, so that's one idea. And the second idea is that we can easily span such a noisy A prime by a matrix A, by the rows of a matrix A that looks random. Okay, and this is under the LWE assumption, and this looks random is in a computational sense. Okay, so the punchline is that this matrix A prime, which is a random matrix whose rows span this noisy A prime, this defines our linear measurements, modulo Q, that allow us to learn the parity without revealing anything, assuming that the entropy is roughly this parameter K. Okay, how do we move from mod Q to the integers? Well, there is a natural approach that, again, I assume most people here have used at some point, which is if we only are allowed to do mod Q operations, we can do operations, sorry, if we're only allowed to do operations over the integers, we can emulate mod Q operations by adding to the result over the integers a large secret multiple of Q. Okay, this is a standard idea. And whenever Q is polynomial, the coefficients that we will need for this approach will only be polynomial. So this is still consistent with being physically realizable, and we draw this entropy from the background noise. So this gives us a solution in the model of semantic security with background noise. There are some inherent limitations that you can prove. For instance, here you only get 1/polysecurity, which you cannot make negligible because if you change, say, a single 0 to 1, it already creates some non-negligible difference. And also you can show that even if you settle for 1/polysecurity, you cannot get entropic security, essentially because you have to leak the level of brightness of the object. And we leave it open whether you can actually achieve this notion of entropic security with leakage. Okay, so in the paper we have more positive results, we have negative results for a suitable notion of strongly learnable F, and we have some positive results for the distributed version, in particular for learning juntas. And there are actually quite a few open problems on the foundation side. I think that it relates to some relatively unexplored areas of cryptography and its interaction with learning theory. For instance, a problem I already mentioned of learning under exotic input distributions is related to a notion of encoded input PRFs from a recent work with Bonnet al from last CCC. We do not understand these questions even for simple complexity, even for simple classes like CNF or DNF formulas. Understanding the classes F that support randomized encodings of functions, right? So NC0 corresponds to the class of local functions. What can we say about other classes of functions? Can we come up with combinatorial characterizations, positive and negative results about that? I don't think that anybody has studied it systematically. What about adaptive queries? The example I've shown doesn't make use of adaptivity. There are quite a few open questions about improved results for linear functions over the integers, better parameters, weaken independence. We assume independence between the background noise and the objects. This relates to all kinds of questions that seem non-trivial, that are analogs of classical questions, but over the integers, and it's actually related to a recent line of work on applying PRGs over the integers for the purpose of obfuscation. So some of these questions seem technically related. And in general, there seems to be room for more theory of crypto over the integers. In terms of applications, looking for more application scenarios, especially in the context of machine learning, and understanding which measurements can be physically realized without leaking much additional information. So for instance, if you want to directly implement mod Q measurements, you can think of using waves. However, waves don't just add the phase, but also the amplitude. So we weren't able to say, we didn't try very hard, but we weren't able to use waves to get directly a linear functions modulo Q without leaking everything. And really, this is the final question, will somebody ever build a cryptographic flashlight using some physical measurement? Really, if the parameters are tightened, I don't see any inherent impossibility. Thank you.
Questions? Yeah. Yes, Ali.
You considered in your model only classical physics. Mm-hmm. Once you think about quantum physics, I'm here. Oh. Once you think about quantum physics, you can say.
Okay. I'm in the dark, I don't have a flashlight.
You can say that nature is performing some kind of encryption. For example, the single photon cannot be viewed by the free loader if I measure it and destroy the information due to the no cloning theorem. So have you considered natural cryptography, which is done by the quantum world?
No, and it sounds like a great direction to explore. Yeah.
Other questions?
Okay.
Okay, let's thank the speaker again.